guide me throughout my life, throughout every step of the way. And so Pastor wants to hear this hymn of the church. And so I need y'all to help me today, saying, God be of that great Jehovah, pilgrims through this barren land. I'm weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, feed me. Feed me. Somebody say, feed me. Till I won't know more. today. I help this word, God, to sink deep within our spirits. God, we need your guidance. On this pilgrim journey. We need your bread. We need your strength. God, we need revival. Guide us today, God. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today, as I pondered and tried to think of an appropriate word, we're in our second Sunday of Advent. This represents the exact Sunday that I was given the opportunity to come and serve as your pastor in 2007. So now as I prepare to begin my ninth year as the pastor of St. Paul Avenue Church, it was critical for me to prepare a word that really ministered the direction that I feel that God would have us to go. Been in revival all a week over in New Smyrna Beach, and I tell you, some people it takes longer to fall in love, and some people shorter. But I tell you, when you all showed up on Friday night, it reminded me of how much I love St. Paul. I was extremely happy to see you all, and felt like home came to New Smyrna Beach, and so very grateful to be the pastor of St. Paul. Word of God today, we're going to look at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 8 through 20. We'll look at the New Living Translation. The scripture says, that night some shepherds were in the fields outside the village, guarding their flock of sheep. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terribly frightened, but the angel reassured them. Don't be afraid, he said, I bring you good news of great joy for everyone. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born tonight in Bethlehem, the city of David. And this is how you will recognize him. You will find a baby lying in a manger, wrapped snugly in strips of cloth. Suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God. Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth to all whom God favors. When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, come on, let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see the wonderful thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. They ran to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. Then the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished, but Mary quietly treasured these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their fields and flocks, glorifying and praising God for what the angels had told them, and because they had seen the child just as the angel had said. The title of today's word is Embrace Him. Embrace Him. to give you a heads up that you're going to need to put a lot of thought into this sermon. You're going to need to follow closely. I'm going to give you a lot of meat. We probably won't get to the point of celebrating through shout. But if you pay close attention, we'll get to the point of celebrating through revelation and inspiration. You know, it does seem socially acceptable during this time of the year that we give higher levels of charity and care around this time of the year, the Christmas season, Thanksgiving. Seems to be a lot more charitable in giving, but even during periods like this, I found that there is a limit to what people will allow in their giving. I mean, we're supposed to be nice. We're supposed to share gifts. We're supposed to give a little extra to church and to missions this time of year, but what I've learned is we better not go too far as to allow ourselves, sometimes in our mindset, to interfere with any of our traditions. Sometimes we'll give and give and give, but when giving seems to get in the way of our traditions, sometimes we stand back and we analyze and we question the liberality of our giving. If there is one thing that is clear from the story of the birth of Christ in the New Testament, it is that God, He consistently and intentionally broke with popular tradition to call, bless, and exalt the overlooked. If you look at what God did, He consistently, surrounding the birth of Christ, he didn't really involve those who thought they were superior. He really didn't involve those who thought that they were elitists. He dealt with low places, and he called low people, and he exalted virgins and shepherds and used mangers and stables. And God was intentional when He made sure to exalt and bless the overlooked. Let's look again at this popular passage. And even people who are not familiar with the Bible, they've heard this passage about Jesus being born in a manger. They've heard this passage about God speaking to the shepherds and bringing the shepherds to see Jesus and sending the shepherds back out with the good news. You don't even have to be a regular churchgoer to have heard that story. But get the context. Mary is accompanied by her beloved Joseph. Let's picture that. Mary and her beloved Joseph. They're traveling together, and they are in Bethlehem in a lonely place. A stable, a cave, a barn. Very likely surrounded by animals. While Mary is laboring to deliver her firstborn son. I don't know about you, but just in kind of getting to know Jesus in the time that I've had to, I can see God, His only Son. I can see God in my imagination. I see God, this Father, pacing nervously in the halls of heaven. Amen. he's entrusted his only son to a human, a lowly human, but still a human. And you know, we have certain tendencies and weaknesses that sometimes with God's best plan, sometimes we still get it wrong. He lays it out and he gives us to it just how he wants it done, but sometimes we still don't get it quite. And now his only son, I can see God in the halls of heaven, pacing up and down nervously in heaven's hallways. I can see him as he sits there and looks and observes the birth of his only son. I see God. Through the pain of delivery comes forth this blessed baby boy. He's wrapped in strips of clothing to keep him warm. And it is as if God the Father had to spread the good news. Anybody ever had a baby or you just want to just spread the good news? I don't know. It was a lady on, you know, I can't even hide it. Y'all that's already been grandparents, y'all already know how it is, and so y'all looking at me like, man. But I don't know. I was talking with a lady on Facebook. I don't even know the lady. We just talked about on Facebook, not like that. I mean, just back and forth. Correct people real quick, but a lady that likes, she lives in St. Augustine, but she's always complimenting the work that we do, and she mentioned, you know, how beautiful. No, it wasn't a lady. This was the rabbi. All right, I got it mixed up. This was a rabbi I was talking with on Facebook, and he mentioned, you know, how proud it seems that I am of my grandbaby Bella, and so I was like, man, I can't even. I just sometimes look at her pictures and stuff, and so he said, you know, it's a beautiful thing, grandchildren. And I said, yeah, I'm getting to know how grandparents feel. It's a beautiful thing. And but he made a statement, which I was like, wow. He said, you know, he said, it seems like with it being so beautiful, with being a grandparent, it seemed like God would have just let us skip being a parent and just be a grandparent. And as much as I love my children, I was like, that do seem kind of nice. But just the whole idea of parenting, you know, and looking at something that you brought forth, and I can see God, this proud father, this beautiful son, that he entrusted to a human, a lowly human. This wasn't the Queen of Sheba. This wasn't some exalted woman. This was a lowly woman. And then put him in a manger, not a palace. And I could see him when that baby came out screaming. And then they cared for him and wrapped him in snuggly strips of cloth. I can see that proud look. I could literally relate to God at that moment, looking at that beautiful baby wrapped up in newborn. He sends out an announcement. He has to tell somebody. Some things you just can't keep to yourself. I know folk get tired of me posting pictures of my grandbaby Alice. And Alice, I think me and Alice on the same page. Y'all just gonna have to get used to it. That's my baby, and I love my baby. And I can see God saying, being so proud of his beautiful son, that he has to tell somebody. Gotta get the word out that a birth has taken place. And so as God goes in and he prepares to get this word out, that a beautiful birth has taken place, that his son has been born with angelic messengers and bright light and glory, he lets the word out. We might expect heaven to be excited and break forth in shouts of praise for this once
history, if it's only going to happen one time, what happened, it'll never happen again. I don't care what kind of teaching y'all see out there, but it's not going to happen again. He's come and he was born of a virgin, and that was the only time that civilization would ever see God born in the flesh. And as never before has humankind taken on the likeness of God in this manner. This was new, it was exciting. The child would literally change the world. Daddy is proud. He wants to get the word out for the entire world. But you know, the dramatic twist in this scenario is whom this angelic announcement is sent by. Something this special, once in the history of the world, you would imagine that some special, some highly exalted, some well-spoken, prepared person that was prepared for birth to announce the coming, you probably would have thought that it would have come from someone highly exalted. You would have thought the first person contacted to give the news to would have been someone that was sits high and looks low. Who is God going to first send out the invitations to? Who is that important that God would send word that the Savior, the Messiah, is about to be born? Who would he give that type of information to? Now, I imagine, I didn't really follow the stories, but I imagine, you know, when Princess Diana, when she delivered Prince William and Prince Harry, I don't know if they sent out birth announcements, but I would imagine that they would probably go to the heads of state.
That's right.
Some political players with royal blood. Some famous folk would probably send it out to presidents and governors and senators and literally human stars. That's just what I would imagine. The announcement certainly would not go out to domestic workers or truck drivers.
Come on, preacher.
No, not those kind of people. And that's the twist. That's the twist of this story of God's birth announcement to the world. Who are the first people that he's going to tell that the Messiah, the Savior, is being born or has been born tonight? There in Bethlehem was born the King of Kings. I wish I had Steve Harvey here right now. You ever seen him do that presentation? I wish I had him right now to tell you exactly who is being born. The Lord of Lords. God visiting our planet this once and only one time. One Son of God. No other verse, no other announcements to be given out. Got to be right. This is the only time this is going to ever happen. Who am I going to tell? This was the biggest event in human history. There was nothing that could compare to this event. The only thing that could compare was when God said, "Let there be." And humans were not even existent then. He created humans after he said, "Let there be." And so this is the biggest event to ever happen in human history. And guess what? The mayor of Bethlehem didn't even get the announcement. The high priest in Jerusalem, they were left off the list. Caesar and the members of his royal court, they didn't get the news first. None of the officials, none of the power elite received the initial announcement from God through his angelic host. The palace don't even know about it. The temple doesn't know about it. Jerusalem doesn't know about it. This first announcement that God gives out goes to a group of sheep herders on the outside of Bethlehem. Why? Why sheep herders? Certainly there could have been more people that were more prepared to receive and carry that type of good news. I mean, this was a once in history event. Why sheep herders? Why? Why not more noble and majestic people? Why waste it on shepherds? There are many reasons God chose to reveal this breaking news to sheep herders. I don't have all the answers, but we'll look at a couple this morning. You know, I believe one was that by giving the message of the birth of Jesus to shepherds, I believe God intentionally provides a glimpse into the nature of the ministry of Jesus as the good shepherd, the one who first got the word and then would take the word and deliver it to the sheep. Another thing that I think is that God intentionally seeks out and uses those among us that people consistently overlook, disregard, and count out. Just allow me to take my time and talk my way through my thoughts. Let's look at the first one. By appearing to shepherds emphasizes that Jesus' connection to shepherding. There is a connection between shepherding and the life and ministry of Jesus. There were great leaders in Israel's history that had a connection with shepherding. You remember Moses, right? He was a great leader in Israel. You remember David, right? A great leader in Israel. You also remember Abel, right? He was the first one to be able to offer an offering that was worthy to be accepted by God. In Exodus 3, we saw where God called Moses while he was shepherding his father-in-law Jethro's flock. He was a shepherd. We saw where King David, he was a shepherd boy when he was anointed by Samuel as king over Israel. He rose from shepherding sheep to shepherding the people of Israel. God had in times past raised up shepherds to lead Israel to a greater knowledge. And now, in that same tradition, the master shepherd of Israel, Israel being the sheep and Jesus being the shepherd, the master shepherd of Israel had just been born. The shepherd of shepherds. Isaiah, he foretold the coming of the Savior. He said it like this. He said in Isaiah 40:11, he said that the Messiah was one that shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and shall gently lead those that are with young. Jesus, he embraced the description as a shepherd. He called himself, I don't know if you remember what he called himself, the good shepherd. He was quoted saying these words, "I am the good shepherd." Then he said, "The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. A hired hand will run when he sees a wolf coming. He will leave the sheep because they aren't his and he isn't their shepherd. And so the wolf attacks them and scatters the flock. The hired hand runs away because he is merely hired and has no real concern for the sheep." That's what Jesus says. He says, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and they know me. I just as my Father knows me and I know my Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Jesus describes the relationship between sheep and shepherd. And he makes it extremely clear that not everybody that's talking about leading you is a shepherd. And the way that you know, because when the wolf come, they run. It was only in it for the money. They're called hirelings. But Jesus, he embraced the idea of being a shepherd. The shepherds on the hills of Bethlehem that first Christmas received the news that Christ the Lord was born. The long-awaited shepherd had arrived, the Messiah, the leader of the people of Israel, the Jewish Messiah. Jesus, you know, Jesus' ministry, we can parallel his ministry to shepherding. By first announcing the birth of Christ the shepherd, God gave a glimpse into the type of ministry that Jesus would have. He gave us a view of what type of ministry Jesus would have by giving the good news to the shepherds, for those who were out there tending and taking care of, they were outside the city, they were taking care, faithfully taking care of their sheep. In many ways, trying to get people to follow the path of the Lord is like herding wayward sheep. Sheep herding was hard work. Never a day off. You didn't get weekends off. The sheep needed attention all the time. The sheep needed constant attention and care. They could not be left alone for a moment, or else trouble would find them. Shepherds were, because they had to be committed to their sheep. You didn't have a choice. If you were really a shepherd, God called you to be a shepherd. You were given the position of, you didn't have a choice, but it don't matter if somebody else didn't show up. You had to take care of the sheep because it was your responsibility. And so they didn't even have a choice. It was a calling. They were responsible for the, you know, I did some research and I just want us to kind of just listen. It was research. My research stated that, now it's research now. Don't get mad at me. My research stated that, well, somebody look at your neighbor and say, "He's talking about research." So don't get mad at me, because you know sometimes Christians get real sensitive. And I'm just going to tell you what the research said. I just was researching sheep. And when I did my research stated that sheep are notoriously dumb. But I know that because there's some folk that might be extremely offended by those words. I stopped to leave those words out because I didn't want people to get, because you know, people leave church and be like, "Who do you think it is?" And so flesh, I just wanted to leave it out so I didn't have to deal with people. Some enough talking going on there. I didn't want to have to deal with, "He think he all this and he calls somebody dumb." But God said, "It ain't about you, wrong. I need for you to make it real clear to the people." And I really wanted to change the word and say that sheep are not known for being geniuses. That's what I really wanted to say. Sheep are known. This right here. This book of mine right here. Sheep are known to eat themselves sick. To eat themselves sick if they remain in one spot too long. I mean, past the root, just eating, eating, eating. Just, they're known to eat themselves sick if they remain in one spot too long. That's why shepherds have to take them and keep moving them, because they'll literally sit there and eat themselves sick, not understanding that they need to move and they need to eat fresh grass and they need fresh nourishment. They can't stay right there because it seems like they're eating, but they don't realize they're eating, but they're dying. Eating themselves to death back there in that spot, put themselves in a place where they can be easily attacked because they got so accustomed, because of tradition, and because it's comfortable, that I feel good eating right here. Don't want to move, don't want to change nothing. They don't foresee danger because they trust the shepherd. And so a lot of times they just eat and don't even pay attention to the wolves out there. Pay attention to the foxes out there. Don't foresee that they mindlessly follow the sheep ahead of them. They just follow the sheep in front of them. Now I know we're all proud, and nobody wants to be looked at as a sheep. But I'm telling you what God called us. He called us sheep. And if we look at our lives, sometimes we follow behind people that's doing the most silly things. We walk right out of church. Heard from God. Get out there and get in a conversation with somebody that's talking something that's totally contradictory to what God just spoke to us, and we sit there and keep chewing on it. Sheep, 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 sheep. It makes them extremely vulnerable to harm because they're in need of a shepherd. There's nothing wrong with sheep, but the way they're designed and the way that they're built, they work best when they work with a shepherd. Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't offend me that the Bible says that when God looked at me, that he said, no, I can't let him be. I need to go make him a helpmeet so he can accomplish. It doesn't offend me that I needed a wife to help me become all that God has called me to be. That doesn't offend me. And so it doesn't offend me if I'm a sheep, if God says, now I didn't make you complete. I made you so that you work well with shepherds. Doesn't offend me. It says that My research, I don't think I'm talking about St. Paul or whatever the church is represented here. I'm talking about my research. My research says that sheep are stubborn. That's what the research, y'all can research it yourself. It says that sheep are stubborn. The one who loves his sheep entirely and will protect them against any foe without flinching, Jesus would be dedicated to bring the children of Israel into his fold. See, God realized that it's going to take somebody with a shepherd's heart. Sheep are good. They're designed to be with me. They're designed to be in my fold. But they need a shepherd to help bring them in the fold. They need a shepherd to help them not to destroy themselves. But they need a good shepherd. Not a hire. Just keep working. You know, Jesus, see, when we look at this right here, sheep, they were dumb in many ways, but in the same way, the sheep of God, sometimes we're not as smart when it comes to God's purpose for our lives. Sometimes we allow ourselves in situations that if we were able to step outside of our emotions and our feelings, then we said, no, now, come on. I'm better than this. I'm better than this right here. But sometimes we don't make the smartest decisions as it relates to God's purpose, and we're stubborn. We get rooted in our own traditions. Sometimes churches will allow themselves to die rather than change.
That's right. Come on. Amen.
allow themselves to die rather than change. Because change means to them, means that I didn't have it all perfect, and so now I gotta tweak it and do something different. Well, if you're human, you're not gonna have it all perfect. And the God that we serve is a living God. Times change, seasons change. You might have did this in the fall, but you might need to do this in the winter, and then something else in the spring, and then something else in the summer, because we have to change. That means that in some kind of way we don't know what we're doing. It means that we're listening to God. Have you ever traveled down the road and saw a sign that said detour? But there's nothing wrong with this.
Shepherds must first have to understand how to be lambs and sacrifice. Yes, yes.
And so Jesus was this perfect lamb. It's likely that Adam and the shepherds were watching that night were being groomed for temple sacrifice. The very shepherds that were called, the sheep that they were watching that night, they were being groomed and they were being groomed and prepared so that one day they could be sold off for temple sacrifice. The very sheep that they were watching. They were sacrificial lambs. Reality is that the Lord God would notify shepherds. That not only was the good shepherd born this night, but tonight a Savior was born to you in the city of David. A Savior, a sacrifice, one who Isaiah predicted would be led like a lamb to the slaughter. A lamb of God that John the Baptist talked about that takes away the sin of the world for you this day is in the city of David. Is born to you, a Savior, and one climactic event. In one person, the shepherd and the lamb were born. Can you see that? In one person, the shepherd and the lamb were born. The second point that I wanted to bring out is that comes across clearly, and then one that has the most and to do with our theme of honoring today, talking about overlooked people, I really want you to catch this, is this. It's clear that God intentionally used the overlooked as proclaimers of the good news. We did that intentionally. I know we see shepherd figurines. We see them all over people's houses. We see shepherd figurines all over the place during this time of Christmas and nativity scenes. And we think of little cute little things and with little holy faces and pure hearts. But the reality is that during that shepherds were really doing, they were social outcasts. They were social outcasts. These sheep herders that received the angelic announcement were not necessarily the mild-hearted, clean-cut altar boys one might imagine. Shepherds were borderline social outcasts. Folks didn't want to deal with them. They were not in the in crowd. They didn't fit in with the culture because they were always traveling and moving with their sheep. They didn't have much of a home life. They were wanderers, drifters, and society that they didn't have much room for people like that. Shepherds had a reputation, whether fair or not, as being thieves. That's how they fooled them. They had to make it how they could. And so folk, they looked at shepherds as thieves, and folk didn't trust shepherds. They looked at them as a little shady. They lived and moved around the sheep. They smelled bad. They didn't look good. They didn't smell good. They were crude and harsh. Their language, they ate with their hands. And they were uneducated and unsophisticated people. These were shepherds, social outcasts. But that's who God called. In addition to social outcasts, they were religiously looked at as unclean. Yeah. In Jewish tradition, to fully participate in the religion, you had to undergo certain rituals and attend certain festivities, traditional things, and service to be considered clean, acceptable to God. Because of the shepherd's work schedule and constant migration, they could not attend all the regular services and perform all of them. They couldn't be going through all this right here when the sheep needed to be washed. Right. They couldn't be going through all these festivities and ceremonials and washings and things. When the sheep needed, who gonna watch the sheep? When I'm sitting up in the temple, somebody got to watch the sheep. And so they were looked at as religiously unclean. Shepherds were religiously unclean. A person in right standing with God was not to touch a shepherd. Don't even touch them. Outcasts, lest you become unclean. They were not allowed to go in the temple. When they did show their faces at the temple, they got those looks. You know how those looks when folk come into church, when they come in and look at you, look at them, and, oh, Lord, they're here. When they did show at the temple, they got those looks. You know what I'm talking about. You don't belong here. What are you doing here? What's your kind doing at the church? God doesn't have a place for you. Clean yourself up. When you want to make something of yourself, that's what those kind of looks at there. And we knew people like that in church sometimes. They're religiously unclean. They're outcasts. And some of us, if we look at the people that God has called to the ministry, called criminals, thieves, crackheads, called all kind of folk that made a lot of mistakes, called unwed mothers, called folk that have made a lot of mistakes, smoke pipe, smoke weed, cuss like sailors. But God called them to be shepherds. But you know something else? Shepherds were backwards people too. And so ain't just sheep jacked up. Shepherds were jacked up too. Shepherds were jacked up. They were backwards people. They weren't down with all the new trends and saddled with the city talk. They were country people, rural folk, who didn't have the latest gadgets. And they carried a rod and a staff. They were backwards country folk. That's who they were. That's who they were. But God calls who he calls, and God calls them intentionally for a purpose. That is who the shepherds were. They were outcasts, overlooked, outside, ousted by the religious establishment. Not good enough for God. So they were taught. That's what the vibe they picked up from the church folk. You're not good enough for God. You're too dirty. You made too many mistakes. Back for too long. Your children got too many daddies. You're not good enough for God. Your past too shaky. You're not good enough for God. You're not a part of the in crowd. You don't make enough money. You're not good enough for God. You're not good. That's what they were taught, and they were out there taking. Can you imagine folk like that out there doing what they do? And they do it because they love it. They do it because they're committed to it. They put their life in jeopardy. They sacrifice a social life and everything else because they just love the sheep. And then all of a sudden, angels come in and begin to talk to them about something that folk been waiting on just the beginning of history. Not good enough. You're not good enough. You're not good enough. Now when the angels appeared to them, it makes sense now why they were scared of him. Why in the world would something dealing with God come and talk to me? Right. I'm sure the church folk never came and talked to him. Right. They judged him, but they didn't talk to him. And now they're sitting out there, they know what folk think. They call us thieves, they call us dirty, they call us sheep, they call us shady, and all of a sudden now angels of a God who judges, angels come out here and meet us in the field while we're taking care of our sheep. And now it's understandable why the scripture says that they were afraid. It makes sense. I mean, of course, just the human emotion of seeing something supernatural is frightening enough by itself. But add to that the teaching that they had been indoctrinated with all of their lives, that they were unclean, they were under judgment, and they were the enemies of God. And now they have these supernatural beings coming in verses 8 through 11. They say that night some shepherds were in the field outside the village, guarding the flock of the sheep, and suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared among them. And the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terribly frightened. It says, but the angel reassured them, "Don't be afraid," he said. "I will bring you good news of great joy for everyone." And verse 11 says, "The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born tonight in Bethlehem, the city of David." And I can see them sitting there thinking they're about to be judged again, thinking they're about to be ridiculed again. And then all of a sudden, this majestic angelic host comes to these three shepherds and lets them know that everything folk have been waiting on to change their lives is about to have been born in Bethlehem. I can see them getting excited, and God intentionally uses the overlooked as messengers of the good news, because that way God gets all the glory. You see, God doesn't play power games with people. God doesn't deal well with inflamed egos by using people that the world considers second rate. God can display his power. See, you never thought I could use something like that, but watch me and see what I'm going to do. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. The shepherd went and confirmed that what the angel had said unto them. In verse 17, the scripture goes further, and it says, then the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said unto them about this child. See, if you use the right one, they'll foretell the good news. They won't go sit back in their sedentiness and hold on to the good news that you put inside of them. Because all I am is a shepherd. I don't even know why he used me in the first place. I'm not worthy. I'm not deserving. But since he thought me worthy enough, I'm going to get up off my seat and go and do something. And I'm going to tell the world that the Savior is born in Bethlehem. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. The people were amazed at the message. And the shepherds could actually hear this amazing message. They couldn't believe that lonely shepherds could come with such great news. How could a former crackhead come tell me that Jesus is the Christ? How could an unwed mother come tell me that Jesus is the Christ? How could someone that lost their home in foreclosure come tell me that Jesus is the Christ? How can someone that almost commits suicide tell me that Jesus is the Christ? I can't tell you why. Because it silences the so-called experts that makes the message available to everyone. See, a shepherd talk to anybody. If you were to call somebody else, they only had a certain group of folk that they were willing to talk to. If I'm at the bottom, I can get it up and talk to everybody. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. Now I want you to listen real close to me. I want you to listen real close to me. Pay real close attention to me now. Jesus, he embraced being a shepherd.
Yes, yes.
He embraced being a lamb. But God intentionally called the lowest among them. I know people struggle all the time in the body of Christ. Because you look at those that are shepherds over you and you say, I'm better than them. I come from better stock. I'm better than them. I have a better history, a better track record. I didn't have all those wild days of running crazy and doing stupid stuff. I'm better than them. And then God calls them and puts them up to be a shepherd. And then we struggle. We struggle because we think that we're better than them. Man. And I can't follow that shepherd. I can't follow that one that God has called to literally sacrifice their own life and deny themselves just to make sure that I can't follow them. Man. And we can't embrace what they offer. What they offer might be good words, but because their verbs are spitting. What they present might be just what I need, but because I don't really like them, I don't like where they come from, I can't embrace what they are presenting. And I read this story this week. It was a woman who, she was shamed and she was brought closer to God by someone the world overlooked an outcast, a religiously unclean person. And I'm going to tell this story in her voice. She said, we were the only family with children in the restaurant. I sat Eric in a high chair and noticed everyone was quietly eating and talking. And suddenly Eric squealed, that's her son, with glee and said, hi there. He wiggled and giggled and with merriment and a man with a tattered rag of a coat, a dirty man, a greasy man, a worn man, his pants were baggy, with a zipper at half mass, his toes poked out of his so-called shoes, his shirt was dirty, his hair was uncombed and washed, his whiskers were not quite full enough to be called a beard,
veins running down his nose. She said, we went too far to smell him, but I'm sure he smelled bad. His hands waved at my baby. He said, hi there, baby. Hi there, big boy. I see you, Buster. He said that to my son, my husband, I didn't know what to do. And my son, he continued to laugh and answer, hi. Hi there. You know our children. She said, our meal finally came and the drunken diesel began shouting across the room. Do you know patty cake? Do you know peekaboo? Hey, look, he knows peekaboo. No one thought the old man was cute. My husband and I, we were embarrassed. My son, on the other hand, was winning through the repertoire of all the tricks of that he knew, and the man was clapping every time my son do a new trick. Yes. My son was trying to do a new thing, and the man was clapping, and my son got more excited than him. My son had connection. We finally got through the meal, and my husband went to bed, she said. And then my son and I, we headed for the door. That old nasty, dirty bum of a man in between us and the door. And I uttered a prayer to God. I said, Lord, just let me out of here before he speaks to me or my son. As I drew close to the man, when I had to walk by, I turned my back to him and tried to sidestep to avoid any air that he might be breathing. And while I did, I had my son on my shoulder. I turned her back and tried to walk by him. And she said, all of a sudden, my son reached out for him over my shoulder. My son started reaching for the man. And then the man's talking to my son. And all of a sudden, my son jumped out of my arms and jumped into the dirty man's arms. She said, but my son, before I could do anything, my son was in this nasty man's arms. And then in an act of total trust, love, and submission, my son laid his head on the man's raggedy shoulder. The man closed his eyes, and I saw tears hover beneath his lashes, his aged hands full of grime, pain, and hard labor, and gently, cradled my baby's bottom and stroked his back. The old man rocked and cradled my son in his arms for a moment, and then his eyes opened, and then he looked me square in the eyes, she said. He said in a firm, commanding voice, you take care of this baby. She said, somehow I managed. I will. She said, it was like I had a rock caught in my throat. I received my baby, and the man said, God bless you. You've given me the best Christmas gift, man. The woman said, I ran to my car. My husband wondered why I was crying and saying, my God, my God, forgive me. The raggedy old man unwittingly had reminded me that in order to enter the kingdom of God, we must become as little children.
outcast, not accepted by the religious elite, looked on with suspicion, led to believe you're not worthy of God's love. Hear the angel's message to everyone in here today. That the Savior is born. Christ our Lord is born. Doesn't matter who's presenting him. What we think about who's presenting him. God uses the strangest among us. But when Christ is presented, you ought to embrace him. Do you have a hard time relating to people like the shepherds? Do you relate more to those who do the overlooking than with those who are overlooked? Do you relate more with the social elite, upper middle class professionals? God wants us to remember that we are all equal in his eyes. No social levels. And God is calling you to honor the overlook. Look for ways to reach out to those that the world ignores. Regardless of how you feel about me or any other shepherd, today I admonish you that when Christ is presented and his teachings and his love are presented, embrace him.